Hello, everybody. I'm Rob Wallace here in St. Paul, Minnesota. I'm an evolutionary epidemiologist with the People's CDC, here with an update on the COVID-19 pandemic. This week, we'll cover the state of global COVID, the state of U.S. COVID, and some of the new research on the damage long COVID is causing. We begin with global COVID. In the graph in red, the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center reports a decline to 2.6 million new confirmed COVID cases worldwide for the week ending October 30th. The number of global weekly deaths, there in white, is slightly up to over 10,000 confirmed deaths this past week. In green, we see what must be an error of 3.6 billion vaccinations this past week. I wish. Instead, our World in Data reports vaccination bottoming out to a little over 13 million new doses for the week ending October 27th. This New York Times map shows hotspots over the past week. The surge in Europe appears in retraction, save Greece, although levels remain high in France, Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. South Korea has returned to the top tier in average daily new cases per 100,000 population. Taiwan also remains an epicenter. Chile and New Zealand are hosting increases. As we can see from these percent changes in caseloads the past couple weeks, rebounds, they are in the warm colors, are still well distributed across the globe, including the aforementioned Chile, Peru, Suriname, and Honduras, slight increases in Spain, Iceland, and Norway, wide swaths of largely unvaccinated Africa, sharp increases in Iraq and Pakistan, and lesser increases throughout Asia and Australasia. At a time when most countries other than China have rolled back non-pharmaceutical interventions like mask mandates, clocking in at no more than 60% on the containment and health index measuring such interventions. Although the latest update of the index provided here is from a month ago. And at a time when the vaccine strategy many governments say they're pursuing instead is failing, much of the world is at best vaccinated for variants no longer circulating. We see uneven campaigns in booster vaccination across the world. On the one hand, Chile, Peru, Uruguay, Cuba, Belgium, Finland, Germany, Italy, and Japan show top-tier booster campaigns. In contrast, we see near nothing in Russia, India, Pakistan, Indonesia, and those even reporting in from Africa. And mediocre campaigns in the US, Mexico, Brazil, China, and Eastern Europe. The collapsing vaccination, hand in hand with the rollback in the non-pharmaceutical campaigns that successful vaccination depends on, is occurring exactly when multiple Omicron subvariants are circulating across large expanses of the world. As of October 24th, we see in some of those countries subtyping their COVID samples, BA5 in blue still dominates, but BA1 in brown, especially India, continues. BA4 in salmon remains in respectable circulation, and now BQ.1 there in light orange. But the veritable zoo of new sublineages now circulating, the offspring of BA2, BA4, and BA5, continues to proliferate in a golden age of Omicron evolution, including 48 BQ.1 sublineages and new entries XAY1.1, a Delta Omicron recombinant, and CP3 and CZ1. Many of the sublineages are converging on the same molecular adaptations or combinations of new amino acid replacements. Those in the circles have developed molecular combinations that permit them resistance to monoclonal antibody treatments for COVID. That is, Omicron is evolving out from underneath many of our biomedical interventions. For the US, this New York Times map shows almost the whole of the country is undergoing slight shifts in COVID cases per 100,000 population. The West Coast appears clearing up for now. The Four Corners are seeing a surge. The Plain States have returned to pinpricks of outbreaks. The Kentucky and Appalachia outbreak continues to hold on. The Northeast appears overall in a slight decline, but Ohio and Indiana appear to be filling in again. Hospitalizations for COVID are low across the country, with pinpricks here and there, particularly in the Northeast. But the take-home here is, in following the CDC's lead, counties across the U.S. there in gray are hosting a spreading contagion of reporting no data. Other modes of tracking COVID-19 are patchy at best, given uneven coverage. We see the levels of SARS-2 virus detected in the wastewater that comes through our sewage plants, a leading indicator of the pandemic, indicates much of the country in cooled-off blues, including matching the drop in caseloads along the West Coast. However, sewage plants in orange and red, representing SARS-2 loads of 60 to 100%, more than their previously recorded levels, are found in Utah, Colorado, Nebraska, the Northeast, and especially in the upper Midwest, including Ohio, where we observed increases in caseloads in the previous map. The more acute measure of changes in sewage loads over the past 15 days show red flare-ups of 1,000% or more of SARS-2 detected across the entirety of the country's sewage plants reporting in, except Northern California. That might indicate an increase in caseloads in the coming weeks, even if hospitals are no longer reporting them in. To sum up, here's the People CDC version of our present community transmission by county, mapped by our own Les Schaffer. It's the combo of caseloads and test positivity that the CDC plots, now reporting those data only once a week. But unlike the CDC, the People CDC differentiates the high level of danger counties are subjected to beyond 10% COVID positivity into high, very high, and extremely high exposure. Down at the bottom, we see that the People CDC also differentiates exposure by both the percent of counties and by the percent population. We see here that by population, we're down to nearly 42% of the American people are in communities subjected to high to extremely high COVID exposure. That's still a lot, even if nowhere near the 90% of a couple months ago. There's also another 40% of the American people subjected to substantial exposure. As in the Times map, we see the West Coast clearing up, the Four Corners increasing, and the Plain States hosting pinpricks. But just because we all are understandably exhausted by this pandemic, and just because the political class took an employer direction to send us back to work, doesn't mean the virus is over us. Along with the surges in various states across Europe, Africa, and Asia, we see SARS-2 evolution continuing stateside, with the B5 variant being replaced by the BA4.6, BF7, and hyperinfectious BQ1 in Kelly green and BQ1.1 in the dark green coming on strong, with all those other supercharged sublineages we talked about only starting up. But it's more than that. Here's the 15-day trend of all the genetic sequences of detected sublineages in the U.S. as of November 2nd, including for some their geographic centers. It's much more of a soup than the previous CDC figure shows. Indeed, the pandemic churns on even in the most unusual places. Climate scientist Brad Rosenheim notes that even scientists who should know better at McMurdo Station in the Antarctica aren't wearing masks, leading to a continuing spike of 45 confirmed cases in a population of 700. Now, we'll finish today with new data on the damage long COVID and other post-acute infection symptoms cause. As the ACE2 receptor SARS-2 targets is distributed across the human body, a wide variety of post-infection syndromes are apparent to the tune of an estimated 24 to 35 million long COVID cases in the U.S. alone. And there's so many results coming in. As Amanda Hugh noted in late October, quote, in the past 5 minutes, papers showing innate T-cell response is insufficient to prevent severe COVID. Long COVID brain damage may be due to autoimmune activation of the microglia, accelerating synaptic pruning, and that Alpha Delta Omicron developed a high aerosol shedding phenotype, inducing convergent evolution, end quote. She adds in reference to the CDC's contention, each of us can act as our own CDC, quote, and with all these new data flowing in, we're all expected as individuals to be able to make informed decisions, end quote, ending with a sarcastic smiley face. From that stream of new results, here are a few observations about long COVID that COVID This Week has picked out. Immunologist Chan Savath Fensufan and colleagues showed long COVID induces an immunological dysfunction that persists for at least 8 months following a mild to moderate infection. Here we see a reduction of cytokine levels at 8 months in long COVID patients in red compared to the controls in blue. Now, cytokines are interferon, interleukin, and growth factors that promote and guide the immune response. Without them, your immune system doesn't function very well. In 2020, a team led by clinical researcher Salvatore Siacitiano characterized the impact this way, quote, both HIV and SARS-CoV-2 viruses induce major changes in the lymphocytes count, with remarkable similarities and differences between them. The total absolute numbers of T cells, in particular of the CD8 subpopulation, are lower in COVID-19 patients compared to AIDS ones, while the CD4 are reduced in both at similar levels, end quote. That implies COVID is an airborne AIDS, if also, hopefully, temporary in its impact. It seems that the so-called immune debt COVID minimizers are trying to blame control efforts instead arises from the COVID infection itself. The resulting damage is found at multiple levels, directly in each organ system and by the loss of immune function at the patient and population levels. Franziska Sotsny and colleagues reported 50% of patients with post-COVID syndrome suffered myalgic encephalomyelitis or chronic fatigue syndrome, and that this relationship was associated with increases in autoantibody levels. With the latter, the immune system attacks its own body. We see here greater associations between the different autoantibodies and clinical scores for those suffering ME in the black bars across different symptoms, fatigue, cognition loss, and headache, among others. Another result, geneticist Alberto Gomez Carballa and colleagues report that SARS-2 NPA2 and 3 proteins may downregulate the P53 cancer suppressor gene for at least 6 months. Here, those patients suffering the WHO COVID severity scores of 6 and 7 in green produce significantly less P53 expression in the RNA-seq data set than control patients or patients suffering less severe COVID infections. No word as to what repeated infection does to cancer suppression. At the population level, we propose the possibility that, like HIV, which in suppressing the immune system permits opportunistic infections to cause AIDS, SARS-2 may be in part responsible for the emergence of that burst of other infections this season, including influenza and RSV, or respiratory syncytial virus, particularly in school kids. SARS-2's apparently successful multi-level attack upon our immune systems shouldn't be a surprise. It's been in a co-evolutionary race with the immune system of the Chinese horseshoe bat and other rhinolophid species that have served as coronavirus hosts for thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years. Bats are the only mammals that fly and must avoid sickness in order to continue to obtain food or just survive. Biologists have offered a variety of mechanisms, including bats' high basal temperatures, hibernation torpor, and ultra-plenty immune resources. That can select for greater replication in pathogens trying to swim upstream against such immune virtuosity, and so ends up producing considerable damage upon spilling over into other species not so well equipped, like us. In this case, in contrast to hundreds of thousands of years of fighting with bats, the virus here is infiltrating human populations over the course of only 35 months so far. With the ACE2 receptor everywhere across our bodies, damage accumulates elsewhere, for instance, in the heart. Yi Hui Yu and colleagues just reported a 30% increase in heart attack for people aged 25 to 44 years. Earlier in the year, Asha Krishnan and colleagues show myocardial fibrosis or scarring in a third of the patients they imaged. Few of the news reports of the death of Julie and Julia author Julie Powell mentioned her COVID infection a month prior to a heart attack at 49 years old. Her husband also recently took ill with COVID twice in the span of a month. Twitter is awash with reports from medical doctors of sudden deaths of young patients. More new results. Here for the brain. Healthy people lose about 7% of the blood flow to their brain when they sit upright. Linda Van Kampen and Franz Weiser show, in contrast, people with long COVID lose 30 to 40% or more of the blood flow to their brain when upright. Here, three long COVID patients, women 37, 35, and 24 years old, respectively, lost 47, 39, and 43% of that blood flow. Infectious disease science Francois Göringer and colleagues PET scanned the brains of 28 long COVID outpatients. They found low glucose consumption or hypometabolism, typically in the right frontal and temporal lobes, including the orbital frontal cortex and internal temporal areas. Depicted here in the blues and greens are the differences between control patients and long COVID patients. Brain fog then may be a matter of lesser blood flow and lesser metabolic energy use. The team noted the associations across symptoms, quote, asthenia or physical weakness and cardiovascular, digestive and neurological disorders during the acute phase of COVID and physical weakness and language disorders during the chronic phase were associated with these hypometabolic clusters, end quote. All terrible results, all of these. Many of these syndromes appear diffuse in nature and seemingly disconnected from SARS-2's initial respiratory infection. But in the face of the medical system's abandonment, a testing program, if not a treatment program, is slowly shaping up. There are a variety of tests one can take to determine the nature of the long COVID that you are suffering. A tilt table test can be used to screen for POTS or postural tachycardia, as shown here. Other tests include transcranial Doppler, skin biopsy, QSART, or the quantitative pseudomotor axon reflex test, endothelial function tests, arterial blood gas tests, PET scans, autoantibody testing, screens for EDS or Ehlers-Danlos overflexion, and for EBV and HHV viral reactivation along the lines of the immunodecline we talked of earlier. And finally, screening for microclots and hyperactivated platelets. COVID isn't just a respiratory disease. It's a coagulopathy, a disease of our circulatory system. Now, I'm not a medical doctor. I don't know all these tests, but long COVID patients have complained that with absent leadership from CDC, few doctors are aware that they can pursue such a testing program for their often desperate long COVID patients. The best treatment for long COVID is avoiding infection in the first place. So get your booster, mask up with N95 level protection, minimize your indoor group activity, improve ventilation, and fight for a federal public health response that drives SARS-2 under its rate of replacement. It's a Swiss cheese model of multiple layers. What one layer misses, another can pick up. This 2 to 8 million global infections a week ain't cutting it. It's giving the virus room to evolve around our natural immunity and our biomedical interventions. That's why it's that governmental response that's necessary, not only here in the US, but around the world. A consortium of 386 experts in COVID-19 response across 112 countries, led by the appropriately named Jeffrey Lazarus, just published in Nature consensus recommendations around intervening into COVID-19, including around public communication, the health system, vaccination, prevention, treatment and care, and pandemic inequities. Most of the recommendations are excellent. The people CDC did not sign onto the consensus when asked, in part because we were not part of the consensus process. We were asked too late in the game. But clearly, against contentions of COVID minimizers who demand we must or even should just give up, the list here shows there's plenty we can do to end the COVID pandemic other than pretending it away. The long COVID data coming in indicate ending COVID transmission is our only option for stopping what is turning into a global disabling event. And that's COVID this week from the People's CDC. You can learn more about the People's CDC and read this week's COVID weather report at our revamped website, peoplecdc.org.